Somebody like me who can't eat the bacon today. Our live stream, and live streaming very important to us as we continue to sell out our in-house tickets. Is this my camera over here? With Skelly Video Productions, thanks to Gabe and the team at Skelly for doing that. Thanks to Sterling Cross PR, Muddy Paws Cheesecake, the new, of course, and Make It MSP for all their sponsorship and their support of Social Media Breakfast. So we are streaming, as I mentioned. Check on our social media platforms for the link. And as I said, Gabe is doing that. If you do participate in Gabe's pregame show, I did not. Gabe, you had a pregame show, right? Yeah. Watch for Gabe's pregame show on weeks or months that you're not able to be here. So who is here for the first time today? All right. Wow. So that looks like I'm going to make a guess about 15%. I don't have anybody back at the table taking notes on that. How many people have been here 10 or more times? All right. I like that. Thank you. Yes. Greg, have you presented 10 or more times? The unofficial answer up front is yes. Coming up next month, March 27th, save the date because registration will be open soon. Social media case studies. If you are a regular here, you know what this means. It means we're going to have three separate groups come up, and they're going to give us some really fascinating insights about things that they have done with clients or with their company. These are always great. And in all honesty, these also always sell out early. We sold out today's presentation about 2 weeks ago, so you really want to jump on it. You follow us on our social media platforms to get the notification, or I think you could follow us on Eventbrite as well. Yeah. I'm not sure there's anything else I can say other than that. What is social media in 2020? We have Greg Swan here from Fallon. Fallon, as Greg reminds me, is on the other side of this wall. At some point, we'll probably just tunnel through because Greg presents here often enough. Greg, come on up and tell us about what the heck is going on in social media in 2020.
Hi! Whoa. Ooh, ooh. Awesome. We're going to see if the projector works. Do not book an event here if you have a Macintosh computer that was built in the last 4 years. I'm serious. We tried lots of laptops, but thank you to Wayne in the back for letting me borrow his. So we're going to see if the fonts and videos break. Isn't that fun? That's super fun. Awesome. So I'm Greg. I love social media. Oh, awesome. We're going to have an interactive time today. Aren't you excited? You guys are already so good. So I am Greg. I do consulting for viral media publishers, and I do workshops, and I have a drone racing league I just brought on. I also work at Fallon, which is actually on the other side of this brick wall. I was over there working for an hour before this morning because agency life, right? And before that, I had the opportunity to work at lots of really cool companies for amazing brands and helping them think about what's new? What's coming next? Looking around the corner, and a lot of times that's social media. Also, my pants went viral last year. Do you guys remember the polar vortex? It's not the polar vortex this year. Claps. So I don't know what that means about climate change, but I'm glad that I'm not embarrassing my kids with frozen pants in the front yard. Do you guys like email? Yeah, okay. Well, I send an email every week, and you can sign up for that if you go to bit.ly/GregSwanEmail. Are anybody going to South by Southwest in 2 weeks? Anyone have coworkers? So we are hosting the third annual Minnesota meetup at South by Southwest. The last 2 years, we got someone to pick up the bar tab because they like us Minnesotans. So if you're also interested in sponsoring, let me know. My wife goes, how the fuck do you throw happy hours and get people to pay for the bar tab? This is how. All right. So I was thinking about social media breakfast. If I've kind of become like the Alec Baldwin of coming to social media breakfast, I had an idea, which is that we used to trend. This event would create trending topics almost every time we would meet. So what I would love you to do in the spirit of this presentation is make some content. If you see something that's of interest, tweet it. If you disagree tweet it. If you want to start a conversation on the digital back channel under the hashtag, make fun of me, call bullshit on whatever I say, do it. It's social media breakfast. Got it? Got it? Okay, good. All right, so we're going to talk about what is social media in 2020, and, you know, really, it's just our opportunity to ruin the next big thing. Right? So it's a big topic. I didn't realize how big it was when I told Michael I would do this. So I've been, like, working through sections and laying out slides and thinking about, like, okay, so what are we going to say and who's going to be here? How do we possibly cover all of this in our 3 hours together this morning? So I've laid it out as kind of where, how did we get here, where are we now, and where are we going? The approach for this morning is about gonzo. Do you guys know what gonzo journalism is? Okay, so journalism, anyone go to J school? I did, yeah, right? So you learn how to approach something as a third party, how to evaluate something's merits and report on it, telling both sides of the story, right? Hunter S. Thompson, the author, you might know from Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, Where the Buffaloes Roam, he had a different theory, this idea of coming into a situation and not being able to detach yourself as you cover it. Basically what we see in mainstream journalism now, where we expect someone to have an opinion. And I believe that the study of social media requires a gonzo journalism approach. We can't possibly separate ourselves from the channels because we're in the channels, right? You guys have felt this, right? We're making a recommendation for our companies or our clients, and it's really hard to detach yourself from that. The definition of gonzo journalism, it approaches an approach to accuracy that concerns the reporting of personal experiences and emotions in contrast to traditional journalism, which favors a detached style, relies on facts or quotations that can be verified. Sometimes you just feel social media. You can just feel where it's going, and it's hard to subtract those things. Also, the personality is as important as the event. Use of sarcasm, humor, exaggeration, and profanity is common, okay? So I believe that we can't report on it. I can't stand up here and be like, so here's how many active users are on Facebook without talking about, like, the real human impact and also my personal journey on Facebook. Does that make sense? Okay, so let's get gonzo. How we got here? Well, the tipping point is that the internet became a freebie. You guys remember this? Like CD-ROMs with the internet on them. On magazine covers. And in your mailbox. And for free at the grocery store. That was the tipping point for social media. So we can go back and we can look at all these wonderful charts. If you just Google evolution of social media, like, you'll find a chart you can steal and put it in your presentation and give a source. Top right corner. Thank you, Miriam Johnson. But, like, we're all part of this, and depending on your own personal journey, maybe you started with message boards. You remember when that first computer came in the house. Maybe you were in college the first time you saw a computer, or at your first job or your second job. Maybe you were really big on ICQ and AOL chat rooms. How many of you had a pager? Yes. How many of you had one of those Nokia brick phones with the snake game? Oh, man. Better days, right? So as I think about my life, so I was in a television commercial that was filmed at my house. That's my dad on the combine. There's me. There's little Greg running in with the groceries, right? And I remember being on television and other people seeing that and asking me questions at school. I was like a kindergartner, right? We had an early computer. I was in bulletin boards. I was downloading Simpsons WAV files of, like, don't have a cow man and setting that for the startup on our computer, right? Starting to steal music on Kazaa, a pager. Had a fax machine, right? And then I had this opportunity, using what I learned at J school, to do what you're supposed to do, which is, like, write editorial, right? So I started an arts newspaper, hired this team, and started thinking about what will people buy, what would they pick up and read in exchange for ads. And then this happened. You guys remember these slides? People used to show these slides, all the new tools, oh my gosh, there's all these millions of companies, and then we had to think about how are you going to organize those things, right? It's like Brian Solis had the conversation prism. Chris Brogan invented this idea of home base and passports and outposts, a way that we could organize, okay, so Facebook goes here and your blog goes here and where does this go? At Weber Shandwick, we invented a thing called content fusion. We would do workshops to talk about, you know, hey, it's not just PR, it's not just advertising now, it's content strategy. Christina Halverson from Minneapolis literally wrote the book on content strategy from this market, right? So we had to organize those things. And then those things started to die, right? So sometimes when we talk about what's next, I'll get pushback and I'll say, wait, Greg, what about Vine? Remember Vine? Like, we invested all this time and we learned it and then it died. You guys know the name of that little kid? What's his name? Gavin. You know where Gavin lives? Here, right? We are center of social media universe, believe it or not. The truth is that Vine was around for more than 4 years. Vine taught us what looping content is. We now make Vine, or we now make boomerangs as a standard ad unit. Vine introduced us to the idea that influencers could interact with each other on different channels and trade off value in a way that we'd never seen before. All the videos are playing, yes. Okay, so if we go back to 2003 and we look at the most popular active users in social media, we got Friendster really high, Orkut, here comes High Five, MySpace is in the lead, here comes YouTube coming up the ranks, there's Reddit, 2006, right? Facebook's coming up strong, YouTube's taking its lead, little baby Twitter, yep, there's MySpace, bye MySpace. Sorry, Tom. Our first friend, R.I.P. Tom. Google Buzz! I'm gonna buzz you guys, right? It's amazing when you own Google and you can just make everyone be on your social network, how big it gets, right? Tumblr, right? The fall of Tumblr is that they banned pornography and now it's dead. Instagram's coming up, WeChat. 2014, right? This is still 5 years ago. Right? Wait for it. Goodbye, Google Buzz. It's falling off the bottom. Ready? Snapchat. Snapchat won't hang out for long. There it goes. TikTok. All right. So that's 2 years ago. Also part of that, that growth, that energy, that worldwide impact was the ability for us to gather and form community, and cause revolution. True revolution, the things that some of us were very excited about in social media, the idea that citizen journalism, that we all have this smartphone in our pocket that has more technology than the first space shuttle that brought people to the moon, right? So the Arab Spring, you had people self-organizing and speaking truth to power in a way that we had never experienced before. The mainstream media was completely caught off guard, rejected it at first, and now are doing it better than ever, and we need them desperately. This amazing ability for us to gather, share ideas, empower each other, disenfranchised groups, unheard voices finding each other, and rallying together. So if we look back, some key takeaways. There were new ways to spread news. You can now make a thing, and other people can see it. It really changed the gatekeepers, right? You can now collaborate and organize with others. You have unlimited knowledge if you want it, or maybe you can build your own echo chamber in a bubble if you want it. New communities, new ways for brands to connect, and it was a total time suck. Okay? Social media made the world smaller. And it seemed to be free, and almost all positive. It was the glory days, you guys. So let's get gonzo. Okay, so what happened? What did we do during that time, right? So I started a music blog, and it got huge. It ran for 10 years. I had a team of people at Guest Pass at First Avenue. We're covering everything. I got the first opportunity where someone said, we'd like to pay you to run a positive review of our band. And I got to decide if I could. Minneapolis Met Blog for many years, which is like a community organizing, kind of a more local than you would get from the start of the year. What I learned from that is just
book on how to use Twitter for your company from this market. Isn't that cool? We've got a new coffee machine at work, and I missed the old one, and I set up a live stream for it. Live streams always help. I ran a Peeps Diorama contest for years and started a blog for that, and then Prince came after it and had a bunch of the content taken down. Yeah, sorry, Prince. And it's social media breakfast. So I'm not from here. You might have heard it's really hard to make friends in this market. Minnesota Nice is a real thing. And because of social media breakfast, I actually made real friends. Real meet space friends, which is awesome. So the 13 of us, any of you here on the very first social media breakfast? So it's 13 of us eating breakfast at Peace Cafe. And it was awesome. And we were like, we should do this every month. And look at this now, look at you guys. Isn't this awesome? Right? And so then you look back and before we knew it, we're at a jumbotron on the lawn of Deluxe, right? And then here we are, what number of social media breakfast is this?
We don't even
count anymore. It's wonderful. And I use those insights. We built a group called Social Media Shepherds that helps churches and nonprofits apply that same thing. Met every single month for 10
years, helping nonprofits, small organizations, churches understand these tools for good, right? Old problems, new tools. I built a social media network called Faxbook, which is just a fax cover page. So if I fax that to you and you check, yes, I want to be your friend, and fax it back to me, then we can go ahead and fax each other status updates. The Twin Cities Media Alliance has a thing called Fall Forum here, where they were training small groups, disenfranchised groups, how to use social media. Jay Gabler from The Current learned how to use a hashtag at this event, right? And WCCO used to throw a thing called Bloginar, where they would get together all of the people on social media together in this market, and we would sit in a room like this and talk about what it meant. And then they would give their password away to all of us and let us tweet the event. You know what I learned? Don't give your Twitter password to strangers. Started a Google Glass blog. And then Foursquare. So how many of you are the mayor of something right now? Do you remember that used to be a thing? So again, in this market, my friend Chris Lauer wrote the book about Foursquare for business. We miss him a lot. This market is so powerful. The community in this room, we have led. We have pushed in social media to see what is next. Checking into stuff is not a thing you do to be the mayor anymore. It's a default on social media now. When Pinterest launched, I started a board just for survivalism and would completely ruin my wife's feed on purpose. You're scrolling through beautiful Crate and Barrel photos and then you'd see an automated chicken plucker. And what we're learning is creative use of platforms outside the norm, using these platforms in a different way to get attention. I started a Tumblr called The Perfect Triangle, where I keep track of toilet paper folds at hotels. I've done this since the first week that Tumblr was out, and I posted one last week. And what I learned is that the Ramada Inn in Kearney, Nebraska can't fold toilet paper worth a darn. Did you know we made Snowmageddon in this market? This idea that the media was fear-mongering a huge storm that's coming, and a bunch of us online were it's not the end of the world, we don't need to stock groceries, it'll be fine, and we all start tweeting about Snowmageddon. We weren't the first to ever use that hashtag, but we were the first to push it to a national trending topic. The Weather Channel started using it. Michael Roventine made t-shirts. We had a live stream of the storm that wasn't coming. And then the Weather Channel started naming every storm because of this market's social media power. I was watching TV one morning and they said the groundhog didn't see his shadow, and I went to find his Twitter account and he didn't have one, so I registered him one. And then I tweeted as him for 5 years. And every year I would reach out to the Punxsutawney Chamber of Commerce. I was like, you should take this, you can have it, and they would never email me back. And then one year it got blocked. And I reached out to Twitter and they said, we are never reinstating this. You are not allowed to do this. So what did we learn? The power of brand jacking. And the need to inoculate yourself. Register your brand channels on everything. I tweeted as a pizza delivery driver for about a year while I was trying to cover the bills with new kids. City Pages wrote an article about how you better tip your pizza delivery driver because they're anonymously tweeting now. learning the joy of anonymous social, right? My car's on Twitter, you'll see that I drove here today. The Martin ramp over at 9th and Marquette, and 10th and Marquette, is a terrible parking ramp, and so I started some social media accounts for them. And so if you want to see the same crumbling, crusty photo of the Martin every day, follow them on Twitter. This idea of, like, don't get mad, get even. Brandjacking is worse than ever. Be sure to register your social media profiles. And then memes. Remember the old school memes? I loved the end of the year, at the end of 2020, looking back at some of the most popular memes of the last 10 years. Double rainbow, Gangnam Style, Rickrolling, right? This idea, the Harlem Shake, this idea that we're gathering together around a shared piece of content that we can also participate in, right? It's a completely different experience. Have you guys done the dances? Have you been Rickrolled? Have you ever seen a double rainbow and just said, what does it mean? Like, they implant in the back of our heads, right? It's a shared common language, and then we can participate in them, right? So, like, here's my Harlem Shakes. Can you turn it up? Uh-oh. Let's try this. So it's obviously my living room in the top, but in the bottom is, those are PRSA Pro-Am college students who just came in for an informational, and I made them do this. and then the right, that was actually my office, and I was on vacation, and my coworkers did that just to, like, fuck with me. Memes, they're this common language, they bring us together, and it's fun, right? It's really fun. And then brands started really teaching us, and we are teaching each other how to use social media. When Frank Eliason launched Comcast Cares, he invented the idea that it could be faster to bitch about a company online and get your problem solved than to call a phone number. Damn it. Best Buy invented this thing called Twelp Force, where they would allow everyone at Best Buy, if you wanted, to sign up to help customers online with problems, really inventing the idea of employee engagement in social media, which is a core category now. The TSA, who today has the best Instagram account in the world, they were the first government or agency to blog, and they started writing really interesting content, and then when they would block your comment for using swear words or attacking language, they would put all of that content that they had blocked on another page so you could see it, and they would explain why. Really innovating around moderation and transparency in a really cool way. And then the Obama White House turned their website into a blog, and the idea that the leader of the free world could share content directly with you, not through gatekeepers. Look at how far that's come. I had the honor of working on the U.S. Army account for 3 years, and we embraced early social media, this idea of storytelling and giving voices to soldiers and helping young people talk to soldiers in a way that recruiters or TV commercials are not in between that conversation. So that you could have someone say, look, I'm maybe interested in joining the Army, and someone would say, here's why you shouldn't. Here's why you shouldn't go after that job. Here's why I love it. Here, you can make your own decision. Let me give you some free access to a soldier in social media. Really powerful stuff. Whether you're for the armed services or against, using social media to drive transparency was amazing and extremely fulfilling. And then, right, like this idea of Facebook 360 is new. So we did the first Facebook 360 Super Bowl spot with Rob Gronkowski. We hacked a cell phone and did the first Snapchat from outer space for Jack Links, or doing innovative augmented reality, or the first Snapchat spectacles in pro sports. Like, what's new, and let's play with it. Let's experiment, okay? So what did we learn from these things, from being gonzo, right? Connecting and testing and proving and playing and measuring. The most exciting innovation of our generation, absolutely. Is it the most important? I'm not sure. Most exciting? Absolutely. Brands have a voice. I think we knew brands have a voice. That's like core strategy, brand strategy. But the fact that you could now affect that voice or have to channel that voice, especially if you're an intern fresh out of college in charge of a Fortune 500 brand's voice on the internet, it's a lot of responsibility. real-time user feedback, this ability to get your answer right away, engage with each other. There's really a law of diminishing returns we saw in organic, where we had built these huge teams to post all this content in social, and there was always that one boss who would be like, yeah, but was it worth it? And you'd be like, yeah, but I think it is, but I can't, I don't, right? Customer care, what we learned is like, don't farm this out to agencies, because like, we're not you. And like, you should try to do it yourself, and we'll help you. Geolocation was baked into everything. Mobile became standard. Trending became a thing. Modern news, it reinvented the idea of how fast news travels. This idea, and we're seeing it right now, where the biggest news dumps are when? Friday afternoons, right? And there, that's still that mindset of like, well, we won't get into that kind of some of those legacy channels, but in social it'll spread. And emerging tech is how you get attention. Also, I would say with 2020 clarity, as we look back, we didn't have enough critical thought about privacy and mental health, bullying, society, parenting, youth, politics. Is any of this worth it? We just didn't have enough critical thought. And a lot of times, some of these founders of these networks like brag that they dropped out of college. And sometimes you think, like, maybe you should have stayed in college. So where are we now? Wait, are we trending yet? Are we trending? You guys posted stuff on social media? Yeah, you just go to on your phone and you just open that app. Okay, cool. All right, where are we now? Well, where we are now is where everything that we do is shareable. Everything can be reviewed. Everything can be shared and commented on. And you almost feel a responsibility to tell someone something or check in or share your review. Almost like we have this like this responsibility as a society that if you don't, you're missing out. If you've read The Circle by Dave Eggers, that's actually a look at that near future. So I'm going to break this into three sections: brands, people, and shopping. Brands. So I believe, from a philosophical perspective in social media, that noise is our enemy. So if you are Coke, your competition is not Pepsi. Your competition is the election, coronavirus, Australia's on fire, Meghan Markle, like whatever is going on, that is your competition. Whatever is in the feed that's competing with you, that is who your competition is. So definitely pay attention to your competition, but broaden that and think about where that's at. How are you going to get there? And what does that mean? That means we have to create a signal that breaks through the noise. You don't want to create additional noise. You need a signal that makes people go, oh, how about that, right? So the modern brands, they're creating their own attention. They're creating signals. They're sparking engagement, and they're driving brand affinity through content and also actions. I just said that. So why should a brand be on social media? I had a client ask me this 2 weeks ago. Well, it's not social media, right? It's not about silos. It's a complement to your entire 360 marketing plan. It's full funnel. There's social media strategies and tactics in the awareness and consideration and conversion and advocacy all throughout. And it gives you brand relevance that you just can't buy. Also, there's a really great report called The Long and Short of It. I have the source there in the top right corner in tiny letters that you should check out, where they talk about how famous brands run big breakthrough creative ideas, and they're also constantly doing brand actions that drive relevance and modernity and give you an excuse to want to tune into them and see where things are going. And also from a loyalty perspective, this sense of like we as humans really trust word of mouth. Word of mouth lives in social today. What are we going to do next? Where are we going, and do I recommend them? So it comes down to this idea. This is like a really rough way of like, I am a brand, and I sell a thing. I want those people to buy my thing. But these people are down here like, well, I care more about news and family and politics and like cat videos. So how do you get in between those things, right? So you need targeted ads, and we have more data than ever before. We'll talk about that in a sec. You need to make news. Borrow equity and influence from other people, other organizations. Leverage nostalgia. Oh my gosh. We're seeing an explosion of Gen X and older millennial nostalgia right now. There's even Atari hotels that are going to be opening, right? So my daughter is 9 years old. She's obsessed with Forever 21. I'm like, what? right? So like, we have to really pay attention to that next generation and figure out what are they going to be nostalgic about, because it's not Pokemon. Elevate the culture, jump on a trend, asterisks, invent a product, tap emerging technology. And the truth is, these are no longer new and emerging mediums. Facebook is 16 years old. Even Snapchat is 8. These are not test and learn channels, like let's see what we can do, right? Facebook turned 15 last week. Foursquare is 11. Instead, these are billion-dollar companies driving millions of dollars in revenue. These are core business channels for us. And it's not too late to learn how they work, but we need to learn how they work right now so we're ready for the next thing. Does that make sense? Yeah, good, lots of nods. And YouTube, right? So now you can watch an influencer video, and then you can use augmented reality and you can try on the makeup. It's really fun. You just want to watch it again? That's good. Yeah, that's good. Okay. So those are like the public social. What about dark social? So in 2016, Mark Jensen and I did a session at South by Southwest called Dark Web and Deep Web and Dark Social. Is anything really public anymore? And in introduced and debated and thought about this idea that the majority of our social media communications is now through text, through chat apps, places that we can't do social listening as marketers anymore. Right? Do you guys see this? Like when you boot up Crimson Hexagon, Radian 6, like in just a Google search, the majority of social content we can find now is on what? Twitter, right? So that's like a very small fraction of the public, and it used to be more. When all of us were blogging, when all of us were sharing content on message boards, it was searchable, but dark social is something that's really hard to contend with as a brand to know where things are going. Now there's this new move to these private social networks, like you and your family could be on an app like Cocoon and just bypass Facebook entirely. I don't think that's going to happen, but I think we should watch it. Also, what is standard right now is this idea of engagement, of comments, of groups and conversation. This is just a given, right? There's also this thing called Godwin's Law, which is like the longer that an online conversation goes, at some point someone will call each other a Nazi. This is a law of nature. It has existed for years, and it is more true than ever before, I will tell you. Demetrification is coming. This idea that Facebook, Instagram, Twitter could potentially hide some of these important metrics to us. We need to decide how important they are to us as humans. Remember, Gonzo, we're humans in this. And then from a brand perspective, which is like, damn it, I need all those metrics, right? So there's solutions to this. That's its own talk. But it's something for us to really watch as that's being tested. Also, the government increasingly has strong opinions about what social media is. As they're coming out with stronger FTC rulings, they're starting to mildly enforce them. Warning teachers they have to disclose ties. YouTube coming in really, really strict. If you posted a YouTube video in the last few weeks, it will ask you over and over again, like, is this for kids? Is this for kids? Like, good, they should ask that. Right? Also, there's this group coming, you know, the FTC and the FDA, the CDC, there's going to be the DPA potentially, the Data Protection Agency, which is Kristen Gillibrand saying, we need an organization of politicians who actually understand social media and digital to help set privacy law. And I think this will be really exciting. It's really important. As a human, like Gonzo, a human, as a brand, this is going to be a pain in the ass. So let's get smart on it. Let's not fight it. It'll be important, but let's get smart and figure out where that's going next. Also, the definition of hashtag ad is drastically, drastically changing. This idea that meme lords are stealing things, and now Instagram has changed their algorithm to source out things that have been photoshopped, so then they get flagged as potential spam. The fact that we're seeing influencers use hashtag ad on things when they're not being paid just so they look good, right? So this is not doesn't have to be a negative thing. In fact, we're seeing that disclosure is good. We're going to continue to see brands paying influencers under the table, and the government and social networks continue to come around the top and try to enforce it. And then there's TikTok. TikTok is the most important social media network today. How many of you are on TikTok? Okay. That's amazing. I'm so excited. Good. So TikTok, You guys know Old Town Road? That started on TikTok. You know the renegade dance that your niece won't stop doing? That started on TikTok, right? This idea, and Dub Smash. So the idea of, where culture starts today, where memes start today, is in TikTok. Now, there's a continuum that we can think about, right? So I call this the, where are you on the why aren't you on TikTok yet continuum? So over here is, I've mastered Facebook, fuck you. And over here is, I love understanding new things in social media. Let's learn a new thing. And so wherever you are on there, I want to encourage you to go to www.tiktok.com. It's free. Just download it. You don't have to post stuff. You don't have to make content. You don't have to share content. It actually has one of the coolest algorithms for understanding what content that you like and starting to feed it to you as you like stuff and watch stuff. You don't have to tell anyone you're on it. Definitely don't tell like your daughter or your nieces that you're on it. So what do I do? Well, I get gonzo, right? So at Christmas, I made an announcement. Can you turn it up? Oh, no.
Jump.
No way.
Don't feel the fall.
There's no way.
Open the water
no
rises. You will tomorrow.
No way.
My daughter was so mad. So then we're at grandma's house, right? Because it's holidays. And I got a niece posse. And I'm like, let's make TikTok. I'm not another word you said. Like, if you show anyone this, they'll be like, ah, oh, that's old. But I think this is the easiest to do, and I consulted a 9-year-old. Never mind, I'll find someone like you. Okay, you get it? Here, it was like this. Never mind, I'll find never mind, I'll like mouth it, and I'm gonna pan it over to you guys, and I want you guys like waving your arms like this, and the longer it goes, just get crazier, okay? Are we good? Are we good? Ready? Ready? Yes, give yourself a round of applause. Okay, so, hold on, I gotta post it. Yes, someone else has got it. Okay, so after you register TikTok, and you go... I'm just gonna watch a couple of TikToks, hold on. Okay, 43%, 49%. So you're gonna download TikTok, you're gonna go to the search icon, you're gonna look up hashtag SMBMSP, and 94%, 95%, and it's upvoted. Okay, so give yourself another round of applause. Awesome. You've all made your first TikTok. Yay. All right, back to business. Brands, we're still in brands. Brands matter. Social in 2020 is more than tweets and promoted posts. It is content strategy. It is audience mining, customer journey mapping, channel mapping, content pillars, your editorial calendar, social listening, what's happening on your website, what do your emails say, what's your app doing, what's happening at your in-person event at your trade show, what's happening at your store locations, right? The last time I was here, I talked at length about email and how excited I am for email. In 2019, it was my New Year's resolution was to learn email marketing, which is so off-brand for me. I'm still extremely excited about email and how it can drive and complement social media. And sometimes you will hear, yeah, but you always show B2B or B2C brands, those big consumer brands, like we're not all Cheerios, right? So I think by now we've proven that every industry, whether you're B2B, B2C, a nonprofit, privately owned, publicly owned, your heavily regulated industry, there are things that you can do in social media. Like, we've solved this. Can you do the same things that Cheerios is doing? No. You actually have a creative boundary that makes you have to be more creative. It's an exciting boundary. So don't use it as a crutch. Think about where what you can do, what are others doing, and then how you can innovate around that and find yourself a lawyer who speaks social media. Social also spans your paid, earned, and owned channels. Remember Peso? We talked about Peso forever ago. This idea that like you're going to do big narratives and brand actions. You're going to have your targeted social ads, and we're going to build stories and conversations. We're going to spend the most of our money in the ads. We're going to spend the most of our effort in the brand actions, right? So you want to get through the content really fast. And I always say you need to eat your vegetables before your dessert. You will get very far in doing fun social media things if you have already proven that you've delivered on ads, that you've already delivered on conversion and things that pay the bills. So eat your vegetables, pay the bills. If that's in a different department, cool. Go buy that person lunch and ask them what they do. Our leadership, CMOs, they are desperate for the PR team, corporate affairs team, to talk to the marketing media teams and really have some connectivity there because they don't live in different portions of this pie chart. It's one brand to the consumer. So if you have made sure that you're paying the bills and you're delivering on the ROI, then you can do the fun stuff. Does that make sense? Good. Okay. Social in 2020 is creating thumb-stopping content, buzzword bingo. This idea that like as you're scrolling, what's that thing that makes someone go, oh, what's that? And they scroll back. Facebook just told us that they're seeing a rise in Instagram ads that are swiped past and then they swipe back and look at them. You guys do that in Instagram stories sometimes? Yeah. That's literally a thumb-stopping moment. Is your content that good? Right? Social in 2020 is more about brand voice and engagement than apologizing. Thank God. Like, I'm so sorry your pizza didn't have enough pepperonis on it is not social media strategy. That's customer care. That matters. It's part of social media. But your brand has a voice that is pulled through. And no matter what the brand is on one channel, it needs to be the same on all. So for example, do you think a social account for that brand can just like, dude, TGIF, thank God it's Friday, right? Happy National Coffee Day, you know? Oh my, OMG for cute, you know? Your brand matters, and if your voice doesn't have a dedicated brand, like, that's a timeout. That's a like, all right, let's go have a conversation and get this nailed. Because, and one of the best exercises for that is think about if you only could write text on Twitter, only copy, no visual, what are you going to say? Why are you going to say it? When are you going to say it? And how do you measure that? Social in 2020 is activating those core values and voice once you have them down, right? So atop your always-on conversion ads and some organic content, your community management, surprise and delight, you need to do stuff in the world that makes people talk about you, that is interesting, that makes them... Remember, again, that long and short of it study about fame brands? Fame brands do stuff in the world as a complement to their ads, okay? So things like for Arby's, right? So we're doing stuff all the time. You know, a Warby Parker collaboration called Warby's, where we're tattooing sandwiches on people, we're selling $6 trips to Hawaii for 6 hours, and then you have to fly right back. Last month, we opened LaDainian Tomlinson's Arby's Steakhouse in New York City to promote the new steak sandwich. So like this idea of like a regular routine, right? We got more coming. There's always another thing. And you have to compete in that news cycle and try to break through and have people talking about you. And social in 2020, leveraging emerging media and technology, this idea that there's always a new thing coming, what should we do with it? Like, we can get attention, even from non-nerds, even for normals, we can get attention by leveraging emerging technology. Okay, so that's brands. People, what's going on with people? Well, if you've ever seen me speak, I continue to say, don't forget that we live in an attention economy. Your eyeballs, your attention, is more in demand than ever before in the history of the world because you all have, who doesn't have a phone today? Okay, so you all have a phone in your pocket. Scott Galloway on the Pivot podcast a few weeks ago said, attention is our most valuable resource as a nation. This is a heavy capitalist guy who follows brands and lots of investing. We are in an attention economy. That makes us attention merchants. It's our job to day trade attention. And attention is also a commodity. If you think about a commodity is like corn and soybeans. It's things where like you don't give a shit what the brand is. You're just like, oh, that's cool, right? So you need to view through this. This is at a baseball game, by the way. This is live on TV at a baseball game. And you know what they're not showing? The baseball game. Yeah. Attention's also a currency. This idea that social ego is fed by attention and likes and shares. Taylor Swift said she hasn't signed an autograph in more than 8 years because people don't want a little signature scrawled on a piece of paper. What do they want? A selfie, right? That's why the politicians are building these huge, elaborate things. Elizabeth Warren is staying 6-8 hours so she can get a selfie with every person at a rally. And again, that means in that attention economy, our ideas have to be thumb-stopping. And my feed is not like your feed. One of my favorite things to do in workshops that I lead is, with everyone's permission, open your Facebook account and then hand it to the person to the left of you. Okay? So with their permission, I don't want to violate anyone's privacy. We're not going to do it today. Don't worry. You're getting worried. I can see. But like, it's this idea of like, your feed is not everyone else's feed. You need to study it and then also look at what you're competing with. Again, if you are Coca-Cola, there's no Pepsi ads on this, right? That's what you're competing with in the feed. Facebook and Instagram have research that came out last year that said that people thumb through more than 300 feet of content on feed every day. That's as tall as the Statue of Liberty. I took this photo, that's why there's no source. And that's only Facebook and Instagram data, only on their platform. So that does not count WhatsApp, which you guys all just installed, right? That doesn't count all the other social networks, all the other apps that you would be on. And Ann Mack, the head of Global Consumer Insights at Facebook, had research that said that it takes your brain 0.25 seconds when you're seeing something on a phone to know that you want to pause and look at it. A quarter of a second while you're scrolling, and the younger you are, the faster their brain works to know if they should stop or not. Isn't that amazing? Have you ever been around a young person and they're just like through the feed? Like, that's why they're seeing that stuff. That's what we have to compete with. And depending on the whatever pop psychology research you've seen lately, we're exposed to 10,000 plus brand messages a day. We switch between screens up to 21 times an hour. The research shows that it's pretty much leveled out that 9 out of 10 of us look at our phones right before we go to sleep, and the first thing we pick up when we wake up is our phones. Then the content on that platform has changed, right? So we now view the world through our phones, to the point that Jack White has invented and pushed forward this technology where you now put your phone in a pouch when you go to a concert so that you'll just put your fucking phone down and listen to the music, right? But we live through our phones. That was revolutionary 20 minutes ago. Remember that? And now we're just like, oh yeah, now we're trying to put them away. There's now resorts that you can pay extra to go to that don't have a signal, right? You can pay someone to put your phone in a safe and not give it back to you until the end of the day, right? We don't have the self-discipline for that. And the content that we're seeing on those phones is drastically changing. The content's half-life is changing, super important. So Anu here, she, and in the thread, details out where she got these numbers. But if the half-life of content is extremely low for things like Twitter, so all these amazing tweets that you're sending, like, no one will look at these tomorrow. Sorry. But blog post is 2 years, 4 years length. So modern language is changing from videos and images and copywriting, all the things that we would have learned and have gotten experts at, moving into things like text. An emoji, what emoji does your brand use? What emoji don't you use? How would you push that in an email? Because more people will open an email if there's an emoji in the subject line. Mixed reality, if you have a newer phone and you Google the word horse, just in the normal Safari or Chrome browser, there will be a little button that says, show this in 3D. You can click on it, it will project it in your room. No special software, no special app. It works for tons of different animals. What if it worked for your brand? Because I bet that's on the roadmap. Right? So we've gotten really good at making brand content for our brands in video and images and copywriting. Like, do you have a 3D map of your product that's ready to roll when that turns on as a native function in search engines? Because I bet it's coming. Now's the time to start to think about that. And then memes, right? Again, our common language, how we share content, how we have conversation. You bring all those things together and you get Aladdin. Yeah, did anyone else get Aladdin? Right? So these are dumb, right? So again, they're really dumb. How many of you have done one of these? Yeah, we all did it, right? That was what happened over the holiday break, right? And so what happens on the holiday break? Well, you're sitting around with your family, so what are you doing? Looking at your phone. So you got to get gonzo with it. So on New Year's Day, I built Toast Chooser. And it will tell you how you like your toast. Do you like it burned? Do you like it medium rare? Do you like it raw? 5,500 people have used this. It's so dumb. It's so dumb. Just amazing. So what do we learn? So normals are going to normal. Like, normals are increasingly on TikTok. Maybe you're not on TikTok. They are. We better get on TikTok and see what they're doing, right? Maybe you don't love what's happening on Facebook now, and you've, like, posted a 150-word post about how you're going to leave Facebook so you can get attention for leaving Facebook because you don't need attention. You probably should get back on Facebook and see what's happening, right? The normals are there, so we need to participate. From a gonzo perspective, guard your heart, guard your brain, but we need to understand what's happening. We need to consider how much noise these normals deal with in our strategy. Modern content execution matters. Having that branding in the first 2 second audition of your ads, that's going to super matter. You got to do it. Don't overestimate the value of organic content. I'm not anti-organic content. I'm about eating your vegetables so you can do organic content. Don't over-leverage on borrowed platforms. If you put everything into Vine and it disappears, you have nothing. Don't put everything into TikTok, but we're building two big TikTok programs right now for clients, and they're a very small part of the big pie, but they're important. Do build content hubs on your own website. Driving that click back to you is always good, especially if it can lead to a conversion. Do use social to link back to yourself. And your ROI, don't forget that it equals your actual time as well as money and your goals. Does that make sense? Cool. All right, one more thing on this, and it's this generation wars thing that we're in. This difference between, like, youth and the olds that we're really seeing acted out right now. So this is coming through social media, right? This idea of, like, you know, don't be a Karen, right? That's like the number one way that my son can get under my wife's skin, is like calling her a Karen, and then we're like, we're taking your allowance away. So like, we're really seeing this elevated in social right now and spread, right? And OK Boomer specifically, right? So it was kind of a thing on TikTok, but then Taylor Lorenz at the New York Times and Callan Rosenblatt at NBC News both wrote articles in the same week. These are like under 30-year-old brilliant reporters wrote about this trend, and they made it a trend, right? They pushed the adoption, and then the baby boomers got in on it, and they're like, no, 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 you, how dare you, right? And then Chief Justice Roberts says, like, I think this is age discrimination. My advice to you is do not say, okay, boomer. For real. It just don't say it. It's going to be, it will be, it's already perceived as an extremely negative thing. If you have that shirt, like, put it in the closet. It'll be funny in 20 years. There's this disconnect and tension between the generations that I think is really important for us to study. So Neil Postman, in his book Amusing Ourselves to Death, says, Americans no longer talk to each other, they entertain each other. They do not exchange ideas, they exchange images. They do not argue with propositions, they argue with good looks, celebrities, and commercials. This was written in 1985 about television. Right? How amazing is that, that this perfectly lines up with where we're at right now? This generational battle is not new. It has existed every time there's like kind of an upcoming generation. In America, youth culture drives entertainment and trends. It just does. There's great books written about it, which is why we need to pay attention to youth culture. But from a gonzo perspective, don't find yourself in the trap of being like, well, they're old or they're young. You need to be a student and be like, what are they doing? Teach me about it. Where are we going next? How can I participate? There's also a ton of pop psychology between the generations about how, like, things are bad or things are good or back in the day. And I would just say, again, like, guard your heart a little bit about when you see this stuff because, like, you know, this one, your kid's phone isn't causing depression. You know, well, two professors examined 40 studies and there's a headline in MIT Technology Review. Like, I don't know. So let's just be careful on that. So generational wars, they're not new. They're new to us. Very new to me. Lived out more online than ever before. They are fed and fueled by social media in a way we've never seen. They're more personal than previous conflicts because now when I say something, you can leave a comment. Or when my when the racist uncle leaves something, you can block him, right? More immediate, they're more momentum, and they intimately affect social media. You need to think in your content strategy how the different generations are going to see your content. Make sense? Cool. All right, shopping. We'll go real fast on this one. This sense that brands are more than brands now, brands are culture, and partially because of the failure of our elected leaders and other people, we're looking to brands to really lead and tell us how things work. So things like REI saying, we're going to give our people a day off for Thanksgiving or for Black Friday, and then it's turned into a worldwide movement. Patagonia saying, we're not going to let Goldman Sachs and these big banks put their logo on the finance bro vests anymore in Wall Street. Or Walmart saying, we're going to pull ammunition for assault weapons because the government won't do anything about the school shootings, but we can do something. So we're looking to brands now to have an opinion and think about your companies. Think, what's their opinion on the world? Where do they stand? Is there risk in this? Yep. Is there reward? Yep. Everything's shoppable. This is his own presentation. How many of you have bought something on an Instagram ad, like, without even realizing you're buying it, you're like, oh shit, like, I bought another thing. The next day you're like, I bought some dumb stuff. And then there's this change where, like, there are now Starbucks pickup only stores. This is in Penn Station in New York. Like, you can't walk in and order. You need to have ordered on your app, right? Now that changes your social media strategy. Because now, like, that tweet can drive straight to an order, which drives straight to them walking in and getting their cup of coffee. Or this idea of like a post-cashier world. If you haven't been, you need to get yourself to Chicago, Atlanta, New York, Seattle, LA, and go to one of these Amazon Go stores where there's no cashier. So you just walk in, scan your app, and then the machine learning cameras follow you around the store until you leave, and then it just charges your account. It's amazing. It's magic. It's complete magic. All right, my favorite part, where are we going? So who gets to say where we're going? We do. Brands? We get to push it. The legacy media, they get to decide. New media, they get to decide. Consumers, they'll tell us. They'll say, I don't want you to wear Google Glass on your face, Greg. The government, we talked about the FTC. Influencers, who's that? Charli D'Amelio. If you don't know who this is, Google it. She's the most popular influencer in the world right now. Do you guys think she's talented? No. Right? Also, like, who am I, right? She's the one making billions of dollars, and she's not even 18 yet. Marketers, we get to choose. And then the next generation, those are my kids, they get to choose where we're going. This is a slide out of Mary Meeker's Internet Trends Report, which comes out every May or June, where it shows the pace of our technology and then the pace of our adaptability to that technology. And as you can see right there, like right there, we are way off that course of human adaptability. Astro Zeller, who works at Google's X, says humans' ability to adapt to technological change is increasing. Good. But it's not keeping pace with the speed of scientific and technological innovation. These things are moving so fast that we can't catch up. And there's always that next innovation. And that's one of the reasons that I just encourage you, and then I want you to keep me accountable, to look ahead with excitement. That same excitement we had when social media was new, and that vision and that hope. And then also, let's pull each other back a little bit on the pragmatic side, and just be like, is that good? Do we like that, right? So it's like walking that line between gonzo, like I'm all in and I'm on it, and then from a brand and student perspective of like, I don't know, where are we going next? So what I'm going to do is show a whole bunch of continuums that I'm tracking, that I think we should be tracking, and then we can figure out where we're at in the tension of those things, okay? So there's a line between we want robots in our homes, and we want human characteristics in them. We want robots to have faces. We want Alexa to have a screen, so when we look, we can talk to her. We're putting googly eyes on our Roombas. And then the other side, which is sort of like we're expected to be really good at multitasking, and you know what humans aren't good at? Multitasking, right? So like where I am seen to be better because I'm more like a robot, but then like we name our virtual assistants women and we boss them around. Right? Like which is not okay. So it's just there's a really interesting line there that I think we struggle with, especially the more robots that are coming into our world. And then the robots are taking our jobs. How many of you are or know someone who will only ever go to a human cashier at Target? Yeah, right? So that's a thing. We're just seeing early days of some of the pushback to some of this. And then there's the other side where, like, maybe human jobs would improve, but what do we need to get there? We need training, right? We need better opportunities to people who are maybe trained in one's core skill if their job is replaced by AI, blockchain, a robot, a kiosk at Target, that they have an opportunity to move up. There's this line between surveillance, where, did you know there's like multiple cameras in this room recording you live and this will be saved on YouTube forever? And surveillance, which is where we're recording ourselves more and more. Remember when I said, let's make a TikTok and none of you ran out of the room? This is the narrative clip. It's a little camera that takes a photo every few minutes and I wore one for a year and a half. And it really creeped people out. I also had a stop motion chronicle of my day every day for a year and a half, which was really fun. There were some wonderful shots of my kids. That idea of like, you know, you're never going to grab your SLR. Maybe you have your phone, but I've already taken a photo. Do you remember when I was wearing this? No? No? Okay. And then these are the... This is my front yard. This is my kitchen. This is my living room. You can see there's like a can in front of the camera because my wife doesn't like them. He's okay, but my son had a seizure in the kitchen, and we pulled the footage, and we took it to the neurologist, and they were able to use that footage as part of his diagnosis. Isn't that awesome? Right? So we've got Ring doorbells, we've got governments misusing Ring doorbell data, we've got Nextdoor blaming anyone who's a person of color on anything, right? Like, there's all these things happening in this continuum that I think is really interesting, and especially post-coronavirus, we might see even amp up as these cameras start to track if we have a fever or not, right? Really super interesting and scary. How do we get that sweet, sweet dopamine, right? Well, you can jump out of a plane, you can push the button at the casino over and over, or you can push the button on your phone over and over. If you've read any of the, some of these, like, I helped invent the unlimited scroll confessionals that have been lately, or the I helped invent the little sound when you pull down to refresh on the apps, right? Like, people are starting to think about those pings and dings and how those have been engineered just like a slot machine to get our attention and have us keep coming back. And the research shows that like it really does like release a lot of dopamine. It really is a really good source of serotonin when you guys all like my stuff. And then I need that and I want that. So there's an addiction here that's super important. And as part of that is inherently this line between, like, is social connectivity good? It empowers connection and intimacy. It allows my mom to Skype in to our kitchen, and my daughter's able to show where she lost her first tooth. Like, really cool, meaningful moments. Like, thank you so much. That's a Facebook portal in our kitchen, right? It's an unrivaled scale of humankind. I Skyped into a college class and taught a course this week in Greece. But from here, that's amazing. That's so cool. And then Instagram husbands. And then this idea that, like, social connectivity is maybe super toxic. And this idea of success theater, I only ever post things when it's good. I'd never take a selfie if my hair isn't perfect. If the dishes are dirty in the sink, I'm going to turn this way. Right? Like, it could be terrible. And we need to watch ourselves. And we have a lot of mental health stuff happening in my family right now. And I would just encourage you, like, if you are in this trap right here, like, talk to somebody. Reach out to me. From a Gonzo perspective, we're in this together too, you know? So just guard ourselves. This is super fun and wonderful. This is dangerous, and I don't know where we're at on this. Okay, let's lighten it up a little bit, okay? There's this line between, like, brands are human, where, like, moon pie is, some days you're the moon and other days you're the pie. Not sure what that means, but if you're feeling sad, yeah. Like, thanks, moon pie, right? Or IBM is an industry-leading enterprise platform that delivers the cloud you want with the privacy and security you need. Take a closer look. Look at the engagement. Like, how, I don't know how they got 99 likes on that. Yeah, the employees. This is one I got this morning, and I put it in. Oh, no, it's in the next one. So there's also this line between, like super fun and social. GIF did this today. How do you guys pronounce this word? One, two, three.
GIF.
Good, hard G, correct. So they did a partnership with Giphy, and they released GIF jars on Amazon, which was awesome. And then maybe that sense of, like, the more that you tweet and are super hyper-aware brand, you get to a point where, like, well, what do we do? And it's like, well, let's kill our mascot on Twitter, and we run a Super Bowl spot. And then there's so many tweets, like, what is even happening? Because people aren't paying attention, you know? This is what I got today, this morning. This is from Alexa. She says, I don't mean to be a renegade, but if you ask me to TikTok, I'm going to tell you the time. There is a Reddit subreddit called Fellow Kids, and you should follow it. And if your stuff is on there, that's nightmare fuel. Like, you do not want your stuff on there. But what happens is the internet self-polices, and they're like, they're trying to be cool. They're trying to speak like kids, you know, they're trying to be, and so, like, you don't want to be in there. This is terrible, right? There's also this tension that we see in humans, like, our desire to, like, not want to pay for content, but we hate ads, right? So this is me trying to watch a tortoise impersonating Owen Wilson, and I'm getting an ad for block online ads, which was wonderful. And then there's the whole, like, if you watch this video, we'll give you extra credits and stuff. And I don't know if you've ever handed your phone to a kid and they're playing one of those, like, Candy Crush games, they'll always watch the ads for the credits. And I will never watch the ads for the credits, right? And then paid content. How many of you have hit a registration gate in the last 24 hours, right? Like, how do you get around that? Well, you open an incognito tab, and then you post it here, and you go to Google, and you try to get around it. And, like, anything but pay the journalists that we so desperately need to write the content, right? So I did the math, and if I paid for all the platforms or all the journalists that I subscribe to, it would be $1,700 a year. Okay, so that's actually, like, pretty in line. It's less than I pay for, cable. It's, like, a little more than Netflix, and it's way more, like, better for me, and I can consume it everywhere. So my wife and I are having, like, a long conversation about, like, are we going to budget for $1,700 so that I don't have to get around registration gates? Super interesting. I didn't just do it, right? We're going to have a long conversation, right? There's also the risk and rewards of earned reach where, like, you know, one of my favorite things to do is go to brand channels and just look at their organic content and just see how terrible it is and how terrible it's performing, and it might be great content versus the fact that you kind of have to have paid and stuff for enough people to see for the scale to matter. Our understanding of influence is also really, really changing. So this idea of, like, genuine advocacy where I would absolutely recommend something to you and it matters, to where I'm not sure if that's sponsored or not, to where it's very clearly sponsored content, and maybe it doesn't mean as much to me. Three more. There is a line between using facial recognition for customized experiences, which is amazing and is completely mainstreamed thanks to Snapchat, all the way to like extreme government abuse where they're using that content for bad. There's a continuum between fun toys for deepfakes. This is an app called Talker Live, where you can make any picture of anybody talk, but it really doesn't look real, right? Over to like maybe it could sway an opinion. Deepfakes were just used in the India election last week and actually changed a lot of people's opinions. And then employee engagement. This idea of like, am I encouraging and empowering my employees to share in social, or is it completely blocked? There are new emerging consumer trends every single week. And we need to be following them. And it can get exhausting, right? There's always a new thing, right? Well, that's our job. So guard your heart, but be looking for those future things. And there's a few journalists that are really great. I mentioned Taylor Lorenz, Callan Roseblatt, that are really pushing the next stuff. And if you just follow a handful of them, or read my email every week, you can see things like, we're all in the bathroom filming ourselves. Hype houses are a thing now. Celebrities moving where you can just text them instead of having to follow them on social. The way that teens are using meme humor on TikTok, or like redefining the jewelry industry. These are things that you don't have to read them in depth, but even if you catch the headlines, you'll kind of have a sense of like, where are we at right now? What's the pulse? Where are we at? And then I have one more kind of big what's next prediction, and I want to make this formally so that I can be embarrassed later. I think smart glasses are actually coming. And there's a quote from Bill Gates who says, "We always tend to overestimate the change in the next 2 years and underestimate the change in the next 10. 4 years ago at CES, there were VR, virtual reality helmets everywhere at the Consumer Electronics Show. And it was the next big thing. And we're like, oh man, in the next couple of years, we're all gonna wear these helmets. And like, let's say there's a pandemic and we'll all just put our helmets on from our houses and we'll all interact with each other and I'm not even here right now. But what did happen is that it completely mainstreamed to the point where it's a couple hundred bucks to plug in your PlayStation and you have VR, and it's like less than 25 bucks for a 360 helmet at Walgreens. It's a stocking stuffer now. So if you look at where this was 4 years ago to today, so I wore 18 different pairs of glasses. These are augmented glasses that project a digital layer on the world, so I'm looking at you and it's identifying your face and telling me who you are, it's sharing your status, it's sharing other things. I don't know what it'll do. I was really encouraged that there was shopping as part of these. That shows some maturity in where we're going rather than a toy, rather than a game, right? So I don't know about you, like as I think about the idea of wearing glasses, walking around town, everything has a digital layer on it. Maybe there's wayfinding, maybe there's added value, and probably there's a whole bunch of ads, right? There's a whole bunch of social engagement opportunities from these glasses, which, by the way, Facebook, Amazon, Microsoft, and Google all have patents on, all have teams working full-time to get these glasses to market. And there will be a consumer pushback opportunity for us to say, no, 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 we don't like that, just like happened with Google Glass. But we'll see. How many of you want this to happen? No, yeah. I'm with you guys. I also am not so sure. I also think if you go back 100 years ago and you stood in Times Square and you said, look, every square inch of this entire area is going to be covered in things that are competing for your attention, things for you to take a photo of and share it with all of your friends, things that moving at the speed of light are affecting you and what you think and where you're going, they would never believe you. All right, takeaways, then we'll get to questions. Create signal, not noise. Plan for social throughout the funnel. Awareness, conversion, consideration, loyalty. Eat your vegetables, Mama said. Embrace your barriers. Don't crutch on them. Follow the normals. We are not normal, you guys. Normal people do not get up early in the morning and sit in this weird Quonset hut with a stupid projector that doesn't work on new computers and talk about social media. They don't do that, right? We do that, which means we can innovate. We can look around the corner and look for that next thing that the normals will either go to or they will shun and dismiss and ignore. Stay a student. There's always the next thing. And I know it can be exhausting. I know it. So be careful with yourself, but stay a student. There are really cheap, easy resources. Facebook, Google, Twitter, Amazon, they all have free online courses that you can take. They'll even give you a certification you can put on LinkedIn no one will care about. But they, like, take these classes. Take all of them. I have my teams just do all of them. And a lot of them are ad-based. Amazon Learning Console is about like building tools and building pages. I showed this slide at the Student Ad Summit last year, and 2 weeks later, a student said, can I send you my Alexa skill I built? And I was like, fuck yes, you can. Like, let me see that thing. It was awesome. Test, make, do, fail, social media, be gonzo. Okay? Awesome. So last quote. From Stephen Hawking, look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Try to make sense of what you see and wonder about what makes the universe exist. Be curious. That's what I want, you guys. Let's be curious. Let's be gonzo. Thanks.
We have time for just a few questions, and I know people are rushing to get off to their meetings, but we're going to start with Gabe. I'm going to hand you the mic.
That was from the audience here.
Oh, it's from the audience. Yep. Can you read it?
I can.
Thanks.
Hi, live stream people. Hi.
All right, so the question from the live stream was, how is the accessibility issue being addressed, especially with consumers that don't have strong enough bandwidth or enough data to load media-intense posts like TikTok videos?
Yeah, so the question's about accessibility, and I don't think they mean ADA compliance, which is extremely important and is like critical, and surely your website teams are working on that, and that's also a thing that you should get smart about, the American with Disabilities Act compliance of your website. And putting captions in your videos and stuff. If they're talking about access, so right now, above us, Elon Musk has satellites pushing high-speed internet circling the globe, and they are trying to get tens of thousands of them above us, circling the skies. It's called Starlink, and it will bring high-speed internet to rural and unreached areas, so entire countries that have not had high-speed internet, and the state of Iowa, who doesn't have fast enough internet, they can use a fucking app to finish the caucus. And that's real. That's real. Like, when I go to Grandpa and Grandma's house in Iowa, there's not internet on my phone, right? So you distribute an app to all these people in rural Iowa, and they can't upload real-time caucus results. Like, that has a huge implication. So I'm excited for high-speed internet to reach the unreachables. However, I'm not excited about the implications for stargazing and astronomy as all this junk is circling the skies. You're gonna be able to see it. You can see them right now if you know where to look. I'm not excited about some of the negative stuff about social media that is now gonna come to new people. So I think we're going to see more of that. My in-laws live 1 mile from where DSL and cable internet stop. And they're on like a satellite, terrible internet dial-up situation. And it's the most frustrating thing ever. That's why I just end up making TikToks with my nieces.
All right, I'm coming. Yep, and wait for me to come over. And if you would stand up and ask your question, that'd be great.
Your first takeaway, create signal, not noise. Everybody thinks they're creating a signal. So what do you tell your clients, or how do consumers influence those clients that their signal is not a signal?
That's a great question. So, yeah, we all love our own, like, we all have the cutest baby, right? So this is the beauty of social media, and in part, like, so with clients who run a lot of media weight on Facebook, we'll actually run creative on Facebook to small groups and see how that does to know which one to then run, which is a long way of saying test your content. It's never been more affordable and faster to do A and B testing. Also, like, set really clear goals and objectives. It could be you want to try something. Like, let's say you want to try a TikTok pilot for your brand, or you just want to, so everyone should register your account, period. It's free. You go to TikTok.com and register your brand account. Please do it, or I will register your brand account for you. But set a really clear goal of, like, here's our pilot. We're going to do it for 3 weeks. What do we want to learn? And then we're going to stop. And maybe it goes so well you don't stop. Right? But if you've set a really clear goal, then you can get started and you can say, our hunch is we'll have this much engagement. Our hunch is we'll drive this many clicks. This is what people will think. Try it and then evaluate.
I can attest to that. Some of our experiments have turned into always on campaigns. Here you go.
Hi. A lot of what you said, I think, is extremely applicable to B2C. But for B2B, will you just give a few tips on, I mean, obviously we can't be as casual as B2C, but can you just say a little bit about where that content is going?
Mm-hmm. So I've worked on plenty of B2B brands, regulated industries, government, healthcare. This idea of a long purchase cycle is perfect for social media and email, right? So if you can't go out there, you can't reach them with a television commercial, maybe you're trying to sell toilet paper and paper towels to office managers, and there's only so many of them. They're normal, so they hang out on all the same social media channels, but you want to reach them with a different piece of content that would be fun, that they would share. So I think you need to look at what others have done to bridge that gap, and think about, in the long tail of that journey, that customer cycle, what could we drip feed them that would be interesting to them? And so it really comes down to, like, your core content strategy. Also for B2B, a lot of times it's getting them into your HubSpot account, which is super great in social media, because if you can just get them to click on something, they're in. So HubSpot has also been a great resource.
I can't have just three questions. Oh, there we go. All right.
Hi, good, how are you? Hey, Greg.
Hey.
Thanks for the inspiration this morning. I love your takeaway on staying a student. And that's something that I try to do too. But seeing all the things that you're actively testing and playing in, how do you really prioritize your spare time and what you decide to stay a student on?
Yeah, so if the question is, like, stay a student, but where, right? So the big platforms are pretty well sorted. There's always a new thing. So, like, this week, TikTok is introducing stickers, and Twitter is changing how threads work. And, there's always a new thing, and we'd pay attention to those. But I would really look at just people versus networks. And so that, again, you know, those idea of, like, wow, it looks like people are buying jewelry in different ways than ever before. Like, if you could study people, that will lead you to the networks. So it's almost like thinking about, if you ever took an anthropology class or a sociology class, or just take some free ones on the internet about the study of people and humans, social media, sociology, right? Anthropology, you specifically study how groups of people interact with each other, and they do this thing called ethnographies, which is the story of a tribe, story of a group of people, and how they interact, and how they get their news, and where they share. And start to approach the world through that lens, you'll actually trick yourself into learning even on a Saturday when you're at brunch.
We can take one more. Who gets the last question? Am I missing something? Wow. All right.
Thank you guys so much.
Yeah. Thank you. Greg, thanks a lot. Don't forget, everybody, to keep an eye out for registration opening next week for our March 27th social media breakfast on case studies. Thank you, everybody. Have a great Friday.
Everybody, thanks for watching today. Check out Skelly Video Productions, like the Facebook page. Follow us on YouTube, and you'll automatically get these when we have social media breakfast. Hopefully, we'll see you live in person next social media breakfast for conversation and bacon starting at 8 a.m. Enjoy your Friday, and I hope you have a super weekend. Thanks, everybody.